Hi there. Let's see, now that the mic might be working, I would love you to applaud for another 18 more minutes, but I guess they want me to talk in the meantime. Okay, so I've got about 40 seconds a slide, so we'll see how it goes. But anyway, this presentation came about because social networking, I mean, I thought it was the dumbest thing in the world. Everybody said, oh, social networking's new. It's not new. And it's been going on, and everybody was like, oh, it's great. And I'm like, no, it's stupid. And they're like, no, it's great. It's stupid. But what happens is, you know, I start using it just out of curiosity, and I'm like beginning to worry about people. Like everybody else was telling me, oh, it's great. I keep in touch with my family. It's great. I do this. It's great. I do that. And I'm like, okay, do you realize you're keeping in touch with like 700 million other people besides your family? They're like, oh, no, I'm not. There's privacy settings. I'm like, get your head out of your behind. Sorry, I stopped myself. Anyway, so let me go on with that. I just went more than 40 seconds, so I'm on behind. Anyway, so it would be really easy to do a presentation on stupidity. I mean, everybody can look at the newspapers. You see one story after another about this. And frankly, it's been around for so long. And a lot of people think I'm like advocating, don't use Facebook, don't use Twitter, don't use anything. And that would be absurd. What I'm really advocating is responsible use, not no use. Because, you know, I use social networking for a variety of issues. But, again, use it responsibly. Don't try to ignore it. Now, the thing is, it's like, I really don't care if you go out and screw yourself. You want to go out and screw yourself, please, be my guest. It'll give me something to talk about at another presentation. Unfortunately, the big problem is that when you go out and you're not just screwing yourselves, you screw other people in the process. You cause damage to third parties, people who are otherwise innocent. That's what I care about. That's what I'm trying to prevent. So if you're in a position, hopefully, at one point in time, I'm trying to help you not screw somebody else, and I'm also, if you have a company, trying to help at least provide advice on how you can recommend to people how they don't screw you in the process of them screwing themselves. So that's what I'm really trying to do, is get people to have responsible use, but more importantly, think about the other guy. Again, do what you want, but don't hurt other people in the process. I mentioned before that social networking is nothing new. And from a historical perspective, social networks have been around for pretty much more than 20 years by this point in time. I don't know, a few of you in the audience might remember the old bulletin board systems where everybody would dial into somebody's home computer on a modem and everybody would get on there and then they'd interact, they'd insult each other, do whatever. I mean, I don't know how many times you go on there. Then there was IRC and there were like all these hackers. How many people are on IRC out of curiosity, so you know what I mean? Yeah, virtual chat sessions, and you know, you have that, now you'd call it instant messaging, but IRC is instant messaging, and where Anonymous grew out of was an IRC channel. So that's a social network that's been around. You looked at IRC back in the late 1980s, and everybody was calling each other gay losers. You look at then 2012, you get on IRC, everybody's calling each other gay losers on the hacker channels. Nothing has changed. You know, it's still in place. Usenet news groups. Everybody forgets what these were, but Usenet news groups had different types of organizations. You had alt, you had the society, you had computers, and then you had all the different subtopics in there. You had mailing lists. Then you had the dreaded CompuServe and AOL, and hackers hated AOL because, God forbid, they made the internet usable for the average person. And then you had dating sites, and dating sites became the source of lots of crimes like Match.com. That, again, was a late 1990s type of application that grew quickly. Then you had blogs where everybody started, you know, you used to have diaries where the worst thing you could ever do is have, like, go into a teenage girl's diary and read it, and that was horrible. Now they're putting it on the internet for themselves, which is bizarre to me, but that's what they do. It enabled cybercrime, Usenet news groups. When I do penetration tests, I would go on Usenet, and it would help me target my companies, the companies I'm targeting really, really well, because everybody was talking about the details of their company. It enabled cyber stalking. I'm able to get the address of a computer and all that other sort of stuff and know how to target the computer with a specific attack, and it made life of criminals much easier. You know, we're talking about, in many cases, stupidity, and everybody thinks I'm just talking about, oh, the dumb users. I'm talking about intelligence professionals sometimes. There was a C4I professionals. This is command, control, communications, and intelligence, mostly military people. Back in the mid-1990s, I was on one of these lists, and then I said, hey, there's people from China. Shouldn't we shut up? Because everybody would give their background when they joined the group. They're like, how dare you stop the freedom of the internet? I'm like, talk to your operational security managers or else you should be shot. So anyway, you know, I was flamed, but I don't care. They were dumb. Anyway, and the companies are dumber than the employees most of the time. The marketing people are out there giving away information. And again, I don't want to talk about commercial, but people who should know better. There was an incident where one of the I don't know a lot of people remember, but in the late 1990s, President Clinton sent a few missiles over towards Osama bin Laden, and the destroyer that was responsible for sending the missiles over had a nice web page for the crew, and the captain had a picture of his family and the family and where he lived and all that sort of. So all of a sudden they had to like take his family and protect them because terrorists realized, hey, that's the ship that tried to blow us up. So they would target them. Anyway, MySpace was kind of a little bit of a, you know, kind of a, what do they call it, a cool app type of thing. MySpace started a trend where all of a sudden people were doing some dumb things, let's face it, but MySpace, all of a sudden you saw these teenage girls post topless pictures of them. You started hearing people starting to search MySpace for potential employees and stuff like this, and it took embarrassment to a whole new level because for some reason MySpace became the site of choice to be stupid on. And again, people were hesitant. Companies were hesitant to tell your employees have a little more discretion. Twitter, though, brought things to a whole new level. Twitter basically went out and gave everybody the ultimate in vanity. What is the big thing people want? Significance. Why does a little kid yell, look at me, look at me, look at me? Because they want significance. Why are there all these morons on Twitter? Because they're yelling, look at me, look at me, look at me, like a three-year-old. That's what's going on there. Oh, I'm eating broccoli for a change. My mother would, I don't care. They're like, I'm on Twitter, I'm going to interact with you. Again, it's a vanity issue. And sometimes it's useful if you're keeping in touch with a group of people. But many times, it took these things to a whole new level because people had, their filter was off. They only have 140 characters to say something, and they went ahead and said it. Facebook became the killer app. Facebook, all of a sudden, it was the best and worst of all social networks combined, and that's what it's becoming. It has the instant messaging capability of Twitter, or sorry, the instant communication. It puts pictures up like MySpace does. You can tell, my God, I don't know why people want me to know about their damn little lamb on Facebook. You know, people are out there saying, hey, you know, I need food for my little lamb. Come to my farm. All I know is if I see a damn little lamb from your Facebook profile, you need things to do with your time. And especially when you're doing it at work. A lot of people I see are doing it at work. That's a dumb thing to do. Yes, there is dumb things. Sorry. Anyway, it puts a lot more people. Then there are the other ones I really don't get. Foursquare. It's like I'm watching a government executive. You know, so-and-so just checked in Detroit. So-and-so arrived in Amsterdam. So-and-so is going to be blown up in Dubai. You know, that's the type of thing that's out there. Trip it, telling people it's like they want to post to Facebook where you're going. It's like, please, rob me. You know, whatever. Then you have Blippi, which is your credit card transactions. My God, it's like I just brought a brand new 58-inch television set. Come to my house and rob me while I'm gone because you'll see where I am on Foursquare. You know, you have Google Latitude, if you enable that. That tells people where you are at any specific point in time of day. You have Scout, you know, which is like online dating, kind of a purpose, but I don't really, you know, you're telling people exactly where you are, strangers where you are. Then you have Google, which has been a gift to me with things to write about. You know, I gave a presentation 3 years ago, is Google evil? They're kind of turning pretty evil at this point by combining everything. YouTube knows when you're searching for lesbian porn. You go ahead, you go to Google, they know where you're thinking about what you're doing in advance, and people do a lot of really strange Google searches. How many people go on, like they got Siri, where can I bury a body, you know, and they do that. That's popular for some reason. If somebody ever kills somebody, they're all of a sudden Siri searches are going to come up and when their kids try to search for that. Then you have Google knows what you're thinking because you're doing it. They have Google Calendar, which goes ahead and they know where you're going to be. They have Google Latitude, which knows where you are. They know more about you when you compile it than you know about yourself at the end of the day. And that's what they want. Google Gmail, Google Apps knows your friends, your data, and all that sort of stuff. You have data aggregators, and frankly, Google is really becoming a data aggregator itself because of what it's doing with your privacy. They're not, quote unquote, sharing it yet, but they've changed their privacy policy so many times, I don't necessarily think you should trust them, but that's your choice. You have things like Multigo, great graphical things that they can show your links to different, like how many different email addresses you have, different accounts and all that stuff. Icanstalkyou.com. Great application. Put a twit pick up, and if you don't turn off the GPS on your cell phone, you know, your pictures that are uploaded on the internet tell exactly where you took the picture. So people know exactly where you are. PleaseRobMe.com takes people's posts that said where they were, all that sort of stuff. Facebook and social networking enable crimes. You know, I tell the story like, you know, there are people who post picture travel pictures on Facebook, and it's like, hey, they're in the Caribbean. There they are. Their Phoenix home is going to be empty, so they know to go rob their home in Phoenix. You have a criminal posting that he robbed a house on Oregon. It's like, that's where I love stupidity. It's like, arrest them. You have Ashton Kutcher. He was a good one. Somebody stole his cell phone. He hacked into his cell phone account, and he also hacked into his Foursquare account. So he was using Foursquare to try to figure out where the guy was, because the guy was logging in as Ashton Kutcher all over, like, the state of California or whatever. Then you have Not a Harvard Graduate. That was her Facebook profile that put pictures of her kid duct taped up. I couldn't make that up when I looked at the profile. Not a Harvard graduate. It's like, yep, you can't even graduate from your community college. So then you had notable crimes. You have APT, is the Advanced Persistent Threats, using LinkedIn. You have the Twitter hack, where some guy from France had nothing better to do, so he hacked Twitter's Google Apps account and was able to download all Google Apps data, and he was able to do that because he looked up employees' profiles that he found throughout the internet on different social networks. Sarah Palin's Yahoo account was hacked because some guy could figure out, where did you meet your husband? Oh, she met her husband in high school. What was her high school? That's all you need to know, and they got her email. Hugh Thompson, who's one of the program chairs here, he wrote an article for Scientific American how he was bored at a dinner party and then got people's permission to break into their bank accounts using just information on social networks, and within an hour he was able to break into 5 different people's accounts. More serious ones, the past ones were kind of funny, but there was an Israeli soldier who posted, we're going on a raid into this town, pray for us. And the Arab, you know, the terrorists were like, I pray you arrive on time. And so that was one thing. You had another guy who was like a web developer, and there was Governor McConnell when he was running, before he was officially running for governor, this guy said, hey, I'm working on Governor McConnell's website. It's like, what do you mean you're working on his website? He's not running for governor. Well, everybody. And then he gets a phone call, and the guy's like, hey, this is cool. Everybody cares about my Twitter post. So it's like, yes, everybody does. A British intelligence officer's wife was reporting on what her husband was doing, which was kind of dumb, unless she wanted a divorce, I guess. Then you have employee issues. I was mentioning national ones. You have, like, recently, like, the FedEx guy who threw a TV over the top or something like that. You had a UPS video guy followed shortly thereafter who dumped somebody's package on the step and gave the camera the finger as he did that. Then you had, like, somebody, well, an employee, he didn't, you had an employee at Popeyes in, well, Broadway in New York City. He put Lady Chinky Eyes under the woman's name, and she was pissed and put that up on Twitter, I'm sure, with a GPS picture of herself. Anyway, but you have that. Then you have other people posting about you as well that you don't want up there. And so you see in this case, you know, Luke Skywalker, now everybody knows Darth Vader's his father. That's an example, but it's a funny example that everybody gets. But I need to throw in something. Business implications. Professionals are letting people know, here's my psychology, here's my medical problems, here's my this, here's my that. I don't care. I can't sit down across from you when I know all your idiosyncrasies. Keeping your secret secret, I'm not saying you should hide yourself, but it's sort of like some things in different environments just don't work. Your company, it might affect you in your off hours. I mean, these are pictures I've seen posted on professional site. I don't care which side of the political spectrum you're on, but either way, you can't sit next to somebody unless you think the exact same way they do and deal with them. You know, the security people, as I mentioned, are as bad as others. They indicate psychological issues. I'm watching people's Twitter posts, and they're like, you know, twittering with hackers. I'm like, you know, that's not a good sign for you as a professional if you want to secure my company. There's a lot of questionable proclivities they're posting. You know, one of my friends once said, Ira, if nothing else, you're a polarizing figure. And so some people didn't like my presentation at RSA last year. One guy posted something. And then these morons who are actually security professionals, I'm talking theoretically esteemed professionals. One guy, you know, like, he's like, wow, 48 minutes into the this recording, Ira, you know, he's like insulting me, but yet he watched my whole presentation 48 minutes through. I'm like, you're demented. If I don't like you, I'm not looking at you at all. But these people are so interested in tweeting something about somebody, they have to go through and put themselves what they describe as 50 minutes of pain for no other reason at all. So anyway, would a normal person not watch? Again, it says something about you. When you insult somebody, you know, generally when you insult somebody, you know, there's the old Brady Bunch line. It says more, well, paraphrasing, it says more about you than it says about them. And when you're a professional, criticizing others is just not a good thing. You also introduce malware by sending out little, you know, tiny URLs. Ads are getting malware. Facebook ones go, oh, we'd have no malware. I'm like, yes, you do. So I wrote an article because Facebook denied they sent people malware. Anyway, introduction to malicious websites. It's more than security. When I see people on social networks, if I see your damn little lamb 20 times a day, I know you're not doing a lot of work. And so there's lost time going on there. I know I miss too much. If I get on Facebook, it's like it's really easy to take a quick 5-minute check to see of something up, and all of a sudden, take like look down, an hour and a half went by. It happens. Brand images can be ruined really quickly. So it's not just security people have to worry about. It really boils down to operational security, in my opinion. Because, you know, everybody's like technical security. Like, yes, some of these little things are like, you know, malicious links and everything are one thing. But companies don't have social media policies. They don't tell people, I don't want you to post this type of information about, you can do what you want about yourself, but if it impacts your company, if it gives an indication of your password, you have no right to publish that type of information, theoretically. But companies are afraid, oh, I don't want to act like Big Brother. It's like, well, if you don't want to be Big Brother, there's, you know, millions of little brothers who are happy to take advantage of these people. Again, want to reiterate, though, it comes down to responsible use, not no use. I'm not telling people do not use Facebook, do not use Twitter. I use them. I actually make a lot of money with that. I'm not denying this. But you have to use it responsibly. Again, it's like, well, alcohol, depending on how you feel about it. But too many people, once you start doing it, it's hard for people because their filter somehow starts turning off, and I worry about that big time. Awareness programs, again, on what the threats are really important. I really wish there was more to say, but it's fundamentally common sense at the end of the day. Again, use it responsibly. Don't ignore it, but responsible use, not no use. Oh, of course, great books for your reading pleasure. What time of year is it? Oh, yeah, great things for whatever. That's about it, and I have 20 seconds. I'm impressed. Any questions? Or I guess I don't have questions. So anybody have a good story we could tell for 13 seconds? Oh, well, what?
What was the last thing you Googled?
What a... I honestly don't remember. I mean, time's up. So anyway.
Thank you, Ira. Thank you, Ira. Appreciate it.